Now, let me tell you about Paul. Paul Merrill was the launch editor of Zoo Magazine, both Zoo Weekly, both in the UK and in Australia. He also edited the UK Real Life, which I think I'm using with quote marks, magazine Chat. And before that, he trained on a very respectable local newspaper, and you can currently find him as a columnist in Encore magazine. So, Paul, let's go back to the beginning. The Farnham Herald, a very honourable local newspaper. What was life like on a local newspaper 20 years ago?
Well, I joined just as they gave up typewriters. So they, the Farnham Herald, which none of you would have read, is a very leafy suburb in Surrey in the UK. And the strict news filtering process was that if it moved, it was reported. So you go to council meetings where they're discussing hedgerows and the rowdies in the town centre and loft conversions. And it was not exactly zoo heartland, I would say. But it was a good grounding. I think the best journos are ones who are trained on local papers. Not that I'm one of the best.
And what were your aspirations as a journalist then? What did you think you were going to end up doing?
Well, I was quite right on in those days, having gone to sort of uni in the late 80s and been very sort of right on left-wing kind of guy who was very much going to change the world and join a sort of proper newspaper like The Guardian or something like that. That was, I guess, my ambition. So joining my local paper seemed the first step on a glorious rise to the very top.
So you joined Chat magazine?
Yes.
Which was,
Chat magazine is, how would you describe Chat? Chat, I guess, is aimed at sort of northern working class women in the UK, women who perhaps, you know, three kids by different prisoners, lots of leggings, lots of very real but lovely women who bought it in their hundreds of thousands. I mean, it had a circulation of 600,000 a week by the time I left, and it was again nothing like Zoo. I'm not quite sure how Zoo came about really, but Chat was very, it was just about their true life stories and about what happened to them in their lives and their loves, and most of it was scandal. It was usually my husband left me for then, you know, my best friends, my cousin, my girlfriend, the dog, the milkman, etc., etc.
Now you touched on the children by three different prisoners, which was kind of what put you on the mark in the UK media. You gave in the UK a somewhat infamous interview.
Yeah, I'd made a massive mistake, probably the biggest mistake I ever made. Having been made editor of Chat and feeling very self-important and feeling like I'd made it, and you know, I was just becoming this celebrity and all fired up, I was interviewed by the industry newspaper, which was called Press Gazette. So a lady came in to interview in my office, and I was just plumped up thinking, I'll just make her laugh, and rattled off loads of jokes, thinking, this is going to be the most hilarious interview ever. But among my comments was the previous one I just used about most of our readers have three kids by different prisoners, they haven't let obesity stop them wearing leggings. And it went on. That was probably the mildest part of the interview. And I just went on and on, thinking this is just absolutely the funniest thing anyone's ever going to read. When it was published, I then got a call from my publisher saying, I think you'd better come upstairs. And basically, I'd done I don't know who's familiar with Gerald Ratner in the UK, the jeweller who was ruined because he slagged off his jewellery and basically made a joke about it and was ruined. I hadn't slagged off my product, I slagged off the people buying it, which I think is probably a step further. So huge, huge, terrible mistake. But it kind of got me, you know, talked about in a negative sense.
And what it did do, though, is it made the phone ring when they were, for the first time, launching men's weekly magazines. Somebody thought of you as a result of that.
Yes, which was, again, a big mistake on their part, I think, because I had no experience of the men's magazine genre. I'd read magazines like FHM and the UK Loaded, which were great magazines back in the sort of late 90s and early noughties, but I had no experience at all with this one interview, which I accept was a catastrophically bad thing to do, and I got away with it, but probably shouldn't have got away with it, was what kind of got me noticed to launch Zoo.
So what brought you to Australia?
Well, after editing Zoo for a couple of years, it was decided not only had it been a great idea in the UK, but we should roll out Zoo overseas, and I'd also already helped set it up in Spain, and there was also discussions around France in those days, and South Africa launched as well. And then it came to Australia. Now, EMAP had an operation in Australia, which had New Woman and some surf titles and some Australasian dirt bike and a few others. So we decided that we were going to launch Zoo. So I was given the opportunity to come out just for a year to launch Zoo and then go back to the UK. So the Zoo launch in the UK was a complete fuck up from start to finish, to be honest. And I take my responsibility as being a part of that. I mentioned earlier about the Zoo and Nuts being this big battle about who would win. It was like Blur versus Oasis. It was huge, and they obliterated us. They thrashed us. A lot of it was because they launched better. The glossiness, the bigness helped as well. But clearly the Zoo launch had not been, you know, the success it perhaps should have been. So I haven't learned all those lessons. I was fairly confident that coming out to Australia, we could do a much better job. But the big fear was that ACP would get wind of it and they would launch against us. Now, ACP being the massive corporate entity with 55%, and Kerry Packer very much alive and very aggressive in everything he did. So I had to come to Australia with my family and my pregnant wife, who was, I think, 5 months pregnant at the time, with two young kids, and not tell anyone. So we told our very closest friends, but I wasn't allowed to tell anyone else that I was emigrating to Australia, because it was thought that if word got out, then ACP would beat us to it, and being the company they are, would just kill us. As it was, Kerry Packer died like a month before we came out. We like to think it was because he, you know, couldn't stomach the fight ahead of him. But as it was, ACP, apparently they did have a dummy ready to go. They were all set to take on Zoo, but in the end it was rejected by the board, and instead they built a gym for all their staff members, which is a very impressive gym, I have to say.
Session before this one was Melinda Tancar-Rist, yes. Collective Shag. She was making the argument that the advertising industry more widely, the media industry, sexualizes and demeans women. Isn't that exactly what you were doing? And it's possible to kind of come up with a kind of bantery answer, but it's yes. Kind of hard to get around that fact.
Well, okay, part of what she was saying was sexualization of children, which I, you know, there's no argument there. I mean, that's not something that men's mags have never pitched or marketed towards kids. I think this is an age-old debate about whether men's mags objectify women, whether they're a bad thing, whether they're very sexist. I mean, I remember going to university back in the late 80s, and, you know, we were all feminists, and we banned the Sun from our student union because it had, page 3 and anti-pornography, and it was all about trying to get 300 women MPs into Parliament, and everyone was campaigning, everyone was, anti-Maggie Thatcher, and everyone felt very angry about everything. So I was quite surprised when I became editor of Zoo, when I was getting sent pictures of, Australia's hottest uni girl and wet T-shirt competitions from, Wollongong Uni and all these kind of things, and girls sending pictures of themselves in, mainly taken by their boyfriends or by someone else. And that sort of anger or that sort of sentimentality seemed to have gone a bit. So I think that has been a step change. Maybe people realizing that actually, is it really doing any harm? It's a pretty girl on the cover of a magazine. I would argue that's not objectifying women, that's celebrating women, that's putting them on a pedestal, it's making them look as fantastic as they can be. I've said this, gone through this argument so many times, I've lost track of whether I believe it or whether I'm just saying this to argue it. But I would say that magazines like the gossip mags, your likes of NW or Who or Famous, all they do is criticize women. They criticize women for having fat thighs or bad hair days or too much makeup or not enough makeup or looking 10 years older than they did 10 years ago. And just all those sort of things, everything is a criticism. Everything's, putting them down, or they're, just... Whereas Zoo, whatever you think of it, it puts women on a pedestal. We didn't even have sexist jokes in the magazine, just because we had an overall policy, we don't criticize women, because we celebrate them. They're our girlfriends, there are, girls that we want to be our girlfriends. And so, I don't know if it's
sounds like the sort of thing a men's magazine editor would say.
Yeah, I think it does, doesn't it? Yeah, I think you're
right.
Not
know whether they believe it or
not. I kind of half believe
it. Going back to something you said earlier, you talk about the women always look good.
Yes.
Photoshop.
Yes.
How big a part does that play in the images that we see in a magazine like Zoo?
Well, it plays a part. I mean, every image is photoshopped and airbrushed, but not as much, I would guess, as some of the women's mags. I mean, the girls in the Zoo are fairly regular looking. The idea is that they should look like the girl next door. That's the kind of image we're going for. Wholesome, girl next door, usually smiling. There's no kind of, if you look at the girls on the cover, usually they haven't got that sort of pouting come fuck me kind of look, because that immediately kind of, you know, makes it look a little bit more, I would say, offensive or liable to get stripped out of a supermarket. So the girls were supposed to look quite a wholesome girl next door with big boobs.
There are a number of photographic techniques you use to hide the nipples, including the hand bra.
Well, yeah, I mean, obviously, because we couldn't show nipples, we decided there has to be a way to show girls in a state of undress where you didn't show the nipples. So you had the hand bra, which we kind of invented. It now has its own Wikipedia entry, bizarrely. And the hair bra, which is clear, the girl bra, when you've got a girl on girl. You had like a house bra, which is up against a house or a wall. You get all these sort of different ways. It's a ridiculous way of operating.
How do you see the future for ACP and for magazines?
I think magazine brands will survive because people still want, if they're buying Women's Weekly, they still want the recipes. If they're buying Women's Day, they still want the gossip. But I think they'll exist in different ways. So I would say in 10 years' time, there might not be many print magazines left, but the brands will still be there. And I think ACP is very in a good place right now. I think it's clearly the market leader. It's very innovative, and I think it's got the right guy in charge, and it's going really well. And I think they are pushing the new technology, and I think ACP are in a great position.
What made you finally move on?
From Zoo?
Yeah.
Well, I'd edited exactly 365 issues, which is one for every day of the year. And I was, getting on a bit myself, and I figured there had to be more to life. And I'd always wanted to write, and of course, being editor of Zoo, the longest articles are about 30 words, and, we have one and two syllable words. I think the only five syllable word is probably nymphomaniac. So it's not an environment where you can sort of, and embrace your creative juices like that. So I fancied a change, and so I took the plunge.
Guys, please do buy the book when it comes out. A Polar Bear Ate My Head. And when's that?
It's out the 1st of August.
And in the meantime, please thank Paul.